Hello everybody, welcome back again. So today we are going to discuss another topic that is much related to the previous topics as we have discussed. So today we are going to discuss about theories of emotions. So we have known that what is emotions, what are the causes of emotions, and how it affects our body physically as well as mentally. So today we are going, what are those theories of emotions which affect our emotions, or which is usually hypothesized that emotions occurs due to these, or how do we react to particular emotions, particular stimulus. So today, in the continuation of this discussion, we are going to discuss the different types of theory. So today we are going to discuss about a simple introduction to emotions, different types of emotions, discussion on different types of theories of emotions, and we'll go to the conclusion, that is comparative conclusion, and last we'll go to the summarization. So let's proceed with today's discussion. So emotions can exist as information to guide how we interact with the world. They can restrict or widen our behaviors according to the situations. For example, fear can make us withdraw and become avoidant, presumably as a mechanism to avoid potential negative experience. So emotions is a kind of informations, or it is a kind of a guide to us, to a particular individual, that how we are going to interact with a particular situation or with the whole environment. Or they can also restrict, that is, they can also stop us, they can also help us to look vastly in our surroundings. And they can also help to motivate or mold up our behaviors according to particular situation. For example, when we face a particular situation which we don't like or which we are being afraid of, then at that time we are going to avoid that particular situation. Automatically, then our emotions will be changed, or we will try to adapt the particular emotions, particular behavior whenever that same situations come across in our life. So as emotions are so central to how we experience and interact with the world, it's no surprise that psychologists have formed several theories about how emotions are generated and how they form our thinking. So below we'll discuss several major theories of emotions that have become central within the field of human behavior research. So many psychologists has done some many different types of research to find out that how emotions are generated within a particular individuals, and how it affects our thinking, our perception, our perceptual thinking patterns or thinking behavior. So today we are going to discuss some theories regarding the emotions. So first of all, we have I'm simply going to state three major important theories of emotions. So the first one is the James Lange theory, second one is the Kanen-Bar theory, and the third one is the Satcher-Singer theory. So we'll discuss this theory one by one in a very simple and elaborative way. So first theory is the James Lange theory. So what does this theory states? That the James Lange theory of emotions asserts that emotion arises as a result of physiological arousal, that is, the self-perception of change in the body produces an emotional experience. So what does this theory states that whenever we face particular situations, first of all, we will have a physiological arousal. Either we will have shivering, either we will have sweating, either our pupil will dilate, we will have palpitation. All this physiological arousal will first take place, and after that only emotions arise within that particular individual. That is the self-perception of change in the body, that is the changes of in the body of myself produce an emotional experience, that how I'm going to behave. So according to this theory, we experience emotions such as fear, sadness, and happiness only after physiological arousal, such as a fight or flight response that occurs. That is, first of all, we will experience a physiological arousal. After that only, emotional behavior will be produced. So one limitation of the James Lange theory is that although this theory said that first of all we'll have a physiological arousal, either in the states of flight to fight response, we will run away, or we will just stand stiff and just shout, or we'll just shiver. All these things are physiological experience. After that only we will experience some sort of emotions, that is, I'm getting afraid, I'm getting sad, or I'm very happy seeing that particular stimulus. So but there is one limitation regarding this theory, is that it is not known exactly what caused the change in the body. Okay, it doesn't know why I am shivering, why I am shaking towards a particular stimulus. It doesn't know why I am starting to produce some that sort of physiological changes in the body. So it is unclear whether this will be considered part of the emotion itself. Okay, so in this theory, there is some sort of criticism that is, this theory is good, this theory is dead. One limitation is that we don't know why these physiological changes occurs in a particular body. So whether we should consider these physiological changes as a part of emotion itself or not. And one criticism is that there is sufficient variation in the physiological arousal to lead to the wide variety of emotions that we experience. So there will be various type of physiological arousal. So we consider that if we are having shivering, I'm feeling sad also. I might be feeling sad also. I might be feeling afraid also. I might be feeling cold also. So it doesn't accept that this theory stating that only the physiological arousal will happen first. After that, emotions experience will change, takes place. So let's see in the bottom, that is whenever I'm crossing a car road, I have seen a car oncoming towards me. Then my heart starts to beat so fast that, oh, there is a car coming. My heart starts to pound, starts to beat, starts palpitation so fast. After that, I start to feel fear. That is emotion. So this is according to the James Lang theory of emotions. First of all, physiological arousal. After that, only emotion change experience will be takes place. Okay. So we'll discuss a simple example. If you were encountered a venomous snake in your backyard, your sympathetic nervous system, responsible for activating your fight or flight response, would initiate physiological arousal first, making your heart race and increasing your breathing rate. So when you are encountering a venomous snake, your sympathetic nervous system will firstly initiate physiological changes such as heart race and increasing your breathing rate. So in this theory of emotion, you will experience a feeling of fear only after this physiological arousal has taken place. Clear? Okay. So next, second theory is Cannon-Bard theory. In Cannon-Bard theory, this theory of emotion was developed in response to the James Lang theory. First theory of emotion introduced was James Lang theory that we have discussed. So after many criticism, after finding out many limitation to this theory, Cannon-Bard theory is initiated in the second. And this theory proposed that emotions arise from physical arousal. Okay, that James Lang theory said that emotion arouses only after physical arousal. So regarding that criticism limitation, only after Cannon-Bard theory states that. So Cannon-Bard theory argued that physiological arousal and emotional experience occur simultaneously yet independently. So here Cannon-Bard theory states, what does he state that? That both the physiological arousal as well as the emotional experience, both will take place simultaneously, independently, both will take place simultaneously whenever the person face a particular situation or a stimulus. Okay, so when you see a venomous snake, you feel fear at exactly the same time. Your autonomic nervous system or your sympathetic nervous system will start responding. So according to this theory, emotional experience result from activation of the subcortical centers of the brain where there is a control of the emotions. So emotion starts from the subcortical centers of the brain. So let's go to the picture. So I have seen a sight of oncoming car. At that time, I will feel both physiological as well as both emotional experience. Fear, emotions, as well as the pounding of the heart is the physical experience. So that's a Cannon-Bard theory. So we'll go to the example of how this Cannon-Bard theory states that. So this theory posits that when you see a venomous snake in your backyard, you feel fear at exactly the same time that the body initiates its physiological fight or flight response. Even though they occur at the same time, your emotional reaction, that is, I'm feeling fear, and my physiological reaction, that whether I might be shivering, I might be shouting, all this physiological reaction will be separate and independent. Clear? So next, third theory is the Satcher-Singer theory. In Satcher-Singer theory, according to the Satcher-Singer theory of emotion, also known as the two-factor theory, it is also known as two-factor theory, emotions are the result of the interaction between two factors, physiological arousal and the cognitions. What happened to those two-factor theories? James Lang theory states that, first of all, there is a physiological arousal. After that, only emotional experience will take place. But after some limitation and some criticism, second theory, that is the Cannon-Bard theory, was initiated again. So in Cannon-Bard's theory, what does he state? That both the emotional experience and the physiological experience both will take place simultaneously at the same time according to the particular stimulus or situations, but independently. Clear? What happened in this Satcher-Singer theory, it is also known as two-factor theory. Here, the emotions are a result of the interaction between the two factors. One is the physiological arousal, and second one is the cognition. So according to this theory, physiological arousal is cognitively interpreted based on environmental context. This process culminates in emotional experience. For example, if you were to see a venomous snake in your backyard, the Satcher-Singer theory argues that the snake will elicit a physiological response that will be cognitively level as fear based on the context. That is, what does it say? That there will be two factors. One is physiological arousal and the second one is the cognition. So what happened? That is the physiological arousal that is cognitively interpreted. For example, my physiological arousal will be based on what I perceive regarding that particular environment. For example, I see a venomous snake in my backyard. At that time, the snake might produce some physiological response towards me, but it will be depend upon to that particular cognitive patterns or thinking patterns of myself. For example, if I feel heart pounding very fast and I feel fear, then only my cognitive level will be said that I'm afraid. Then only I will show my emotion. If I saw a snake and I see that snake as a simple stimulus, or I don't get fear of that particular stimulus, then I will not have any physiological arousal as well as my cognitive or my thinking pattern has already taken the stimulus as a simple basis, and I don't feel afraid. So physiological arousal and the cognition are the two factors that affect a particular individual to show their particular emotions. Let's discuss in a simple example. Okay, so if you see a venomous snake in your backyard, the theory states that snake would elicit sympathetic nervous system activation, physiological arousal. For example, I see a snake, automatically my heart, I will be somewhat feeling palpitation, stiffness sometime, or I might be having some sweating. That is physiological arousal. That will be cognitively labeled as fear. Then I will think that, oh, I'm feeling this sweating, or I'm having fast pounding of the heartbeat, or I'm having increasing pattern of breathing pattern. Then I will think that, oh, this is due to my fear, that I'm getting fear. That is my thinking pattern. What will you actually experience then will be the feeling of the fear. After that only I will show up my emotion, that is fear. Okay, even though when I see a car running through the highway, and if my physiological arousal doesn't change, it's quite normal as I am, then I will perceive that I'm feeling normal. Then I won't show any emotions of fear or anxiety or sad only. Okay, so first the physiological arousal will happen due to the sympathetic nervous system, and after that only my cognition or my thinking process will take that as a fear, and after that only I will show up the emotions of feeling of fear. Clear? So let's compare these three theories. First one is the canon, sorry, James Lang theory. Second one is the canon bar theory, and third one was the Satcher theory. So let's compare these three theories and find out what are the main differences and how they are interpreted according to them. So first one is the common sense. We all know that when we see a wolf or when we see a lion or tiger or wild animals, subjective experience will be fear. I feel fear. After that only my body will respond. If I don't feel fear, my body won't respond. Okay, so my heart is pounding because I feel afraid. So the person, we it's normal, quite normal. Then we will state that my heart starts to feel so fast, pounds so fast because I was feeling afraid due to that particular stimulus. Because I have saw that lion approaching me, because I have saw that wolf barking to me, through me, yowling through me. So this is the kind of common sense. But what happens in James Lang theory? What he says is that before getting that subjective experience of fear, my body response arousal takes place first. After that only, subjective experience of fear will be, or emotions will be produced. So I feel afraid because my heart is pounding. Then the person will say that I'm feeling afraid because my heart was pounding so fast. Okay. Second is Canon Bar theory. What he states that both the physiological and the emotional experience will take place simultaneously. So what will be the report? The dog makes me feel afraid and my heart pounding simultaneously. Here's the report, or here's the verbatim that a particular individual will state. Last one is the Satcher theory. What he stated? Here is that the person is having body response, that is arousal. That information will go to the cognitive process to thinking, and I will be feeling fear. In first two, there will be no process of cognitive thinking or no process of perception. But in the last Satcher syndrome theory, the person will feel, have some sort of body arousal. After that, having the cognition that, oh, this is due to fear. Then after that only, subjective experience of fear or the emotions will be solved. So what will the person say, or what will conclude with this particular theory is that my pounding heart means I'm having pounding, my heart is pulping so fast because I'm afraid, because I interpret the situation as a dangerous. I thought that this will be so dangerous, so my heart start pumping so fast, so I'm feeling fear. Clear? So this is the simple comparative ideas of the theories of the emotions. Clear? So in conclusion, research of emotion has increased over the past two decades, with many fields contributing, including psychology, medicine, history, sociology of emotions, and computer science. The numerous theories that attempt to explain the origin, function, and other aspects of emotion have fostered more intense research on this topic. Even though we have these three main theories of emotions, researchers are still continuing different types of researches in the basis of psychology, medicine, sociology of emotions, history, and computer science to find out the origin of emotions and how it is started, how it affects the body, and what are different aspects of the emotions. And this point or this area has focused more researchers to focus more deeply towards a particular topic. So although emotions are notoriously difficult to define, there is a little denying that they play a huge role in our life. We know that emotions play a very, very important role in our life. They often rule over how we interact with the world, biasing our perception when we encounter new stimuli and shaping how we attend to stimuli too. So even though we know that defining an emotion is quite difficult, but it affects our body in various and different types of way. So we will, according to the emotions, it will help us to adjust to a particular situation, particular new stimulus, and our perception will also change with this particular emotion. So today we have discussed about what are the simple introduction to emotions, different type of theories, different types of the theories of the emotions elaboratively. And we know that there are three theories. One is the James Lang theory, and after certain criticism, certain limitations, next Canon Bar theory was produced. And after that, quite different from these two theory, the last one, Satcher and the two factor theory, was introduced. So I hope today the theories of emotion is quite simple and quite important. However, I hope that all of you might be clear with today's topic. And thank you, everyone. So have a nice day, and let's meet in another next topic. Thank you.